Good morning.
Good morning.
Y'all are still talking.
Good morning.
It is so good to see so many people here. You know, we have more people here last week because of Mother's Day. And traditionally, the Sunday after Mother's Day is like the Sunday after Easter. And so, you know, or the Sunday after Christmas. But I'm so glad to see you here. It's so good seeing some of you here who I haven't seen in a long time. You guys are still talking.
I know. What is that?
It's good. I'm glad they're talking. Brenda Verdell?
Brian, your teacher's there.
I know. There's the teacher's there. She's not looking at me.
She doesn't hear you. She doesn't say hey.
That's right. But it's so good to see so many of you here. A couple of announcements, a few announcements actually. We have the Shiloh Homecoming next week at 1 o'clock. Where we have a picnic dinner, weather permitting. And then we have worship at the Shiloh Church. For those of you who don't know what Shiloh Church is, there's a thing in your bulletin that explains what it is. But it is the oldest church building in South Carolina. It's Spartanburg County, and we're the caretakers of that building. And it is an absolutely wonderful and beautiful building that has a lot of history. And so, and every year, except for last year because of the pandemic, we did a homecoming. And so this year we're going to do the homecoming again, which is great news. We even got the songs picked out. What song are we doing, Richard? Ricky D?
Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace.
I'll Fly Away.
I'll Fly Away. That's old school. I'll Fly Away.
When the road is called up yonder.
And When the Road is Called Up Yonder. So I hope you can make it. Now I got Ricky D in my mind. Rick over at Grambling will be doing the sermon. Rick Rand over at Grambling. Thank you.
And we will have a choir rehearsal this Wednesday.
There's going to be a choir rehearsal, which is good because yes. I miss the choir.
Yes.
I do. I miss the choir. So we're going to have a choir rehearsal this Wednesday. Hope you can make it. What time, Vicki?
7 o'clock.
So for some of you who are online watching, we have choir rehearsal at 7 o'clock. Also, youth are going to do the escape room today.
Yes.
Which is exciting.
I know.
Because I like escape rooms. And I'll be going.
Yeah.
And that's even more exciting. And so we're going to do an escape room. We're meeting here at 4:15. We're going to be here at 4:15 to go. We're having a trustees meeting this Thursday at 6:30 o'clock. Hope you can make it. Also, we're going to plan a worship committee meeting. I don't have a date set yet, but one of the things I want to hear from you as a church is, you know, we stopped meeting on March 14th. And then when we met back again on June 14th, we did sort of an abbreviated worship service. There are some things that I miss. There are some things I don't miss. I want to hear from you about some of the things you miss or don't miss. For instance, I miss children doing the accolades. And I'm sure some of you do too. What I don't miss is doing three hymns. Apparently that was a bit excessive, right? So there are some things that we do differently now that I think work out well. One I would argue, we do the offering pretty well now, right? Because we actually don't do it. but we do fine with how we're collecting offerings now, our tithes. And so I want to hear from you about what you miss, what you don't miss, and what we can do in the future to make our worship service forward-focused. Amen? All right. Finally, brothers and sisters, if you'll lift up Horace. Horace is going to go to Houston for some treatments, and if you'll think about him, you know, he's one of our patriarchs, and we all love him dearly. So if you'll lift him up in your thoughts and prayers. Brothers and sisters, let's open up our hearts and minds to worship. Thank you. Brothers and sisters, please stand and join me in the call of worship found in your bulletin. For those of you who are online, you will respond by saying, "Our hearts are joyful, O Lord, when we love one another. Our hearts are joyful, O Lord, when we love one another." Jesus prays for his disciples, saying, "I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves."
Our hearts are joyful, O Lord, when we love one another.
We hear joy when the pains of hunger are replaced with the sounds of laughter over a shared meal provided by our hands. Joy is found when we show compassion.
Our hearts are joyful, O Lord, when we love one another.
We feel joy when those who have been outcast value themselves as children of God because we welcome them. Joy is found when we choose kindness.
Our hearts are joyful, O Lord, when we love one another.
We see joy when the oppressed rise in protest as we take up their cause and march with them. Joy is found when we work for justice.
Our hearts are joyful, O Lord, when we love one another.
We share joy when we gather together with our differing thoughts and opinions and find common ground through grace and conversation. Joy is found when we strive for peace.
Our hearts are joyful, O Lord, when we love one another.
Thank you.
So I need to admit something to you. Well, one, that's one of my favorite hymns.
Love that hymn.
But I need to admit something to you. When I was in seminary, I was not always the best student, and I know that surprises you. And I did well in like my New Testament survey classes, and I did well in my theology courses, and I did great in my ethic courses. But where I struggled was in my language courses. I could not grasp Hebrew at all. And I didn't do much better with Greek, and both were requirements for my seminary degree. And I remember one time I wasn't doing well, and I thought about dropping the Hebrew class. And I sat down with the professor, and I was like, look, man. I said, look, man. At the rate we're going, I'm going to fail this course. And I don't know what to do, so I might need to drop this class. And the professor looked at me, and he said, I didn't look at you. I never saw you as a quitter. But then he said this. If you stay focused, we'll get through this together. I know it is difficult, but if you stay focused, we'll get through this together. And we did, and I passed, sort of.
He was kind.
He was very generous. Brothers and sisters, the world is rough sometimes, isn't it? And we deal with stuff in life that makes things difficult. But if we stick together, and if we stay focused, we'll get through it. The Hebrew reading is Psalm 1, and that's what it talks about. Staying focused, staying together, and sticking to it. Hear the words. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They're like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so. They're like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall perish. Brothers and sisters, life can be difficult. The challenges we face can sometimes feel insurmountable. Stay focused, and we'll get through this together. Amen?
Amen.
Let's go to God in prayer. Struggle with family issues or with job issues or even with our faith. Lord, inspire us to stay focused. Lead us to stick together by loving one another. And Lord, may we find joy by being resolute to follow in the ways of love. Hear us as we pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples by our saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Will the children please join me for our time together?
That's all right. I want to show you a painting. One of our former youth was now a college
twisty
student.
Twisty pets.
What?
Twisty.
I love those twisty pets. Can I have one?
No. Yeah.
They're girly. Yeah. Ah, come on. I'm going to show you a picture of one of our former youth who is now a college student painted.
That looks like a church sign.
It's the United Methodist emblem.
I saw it.
You see the sign all over this building.
I saw it from the back of the building.
Okay, all right. Now let me ask you something. Do you think this is her very first painting ever?
No. Did she make it?
No, she did not make it. No, that's a huge compliment, right?
I know. I'm not that artistic, but thank you,
Kenan. That's my recent college student.
Right.
No, but do you think she did this? This is her first painting?
No.
Yes.
No.
It's not. Why don't you think it's her first painting?
Because she.
No. What? Yes.
Because she takes art class and she probably drew something else in art class.
So this looks like someone took art class?
Yeah.
Vivian, what were you going to say?
Because you need to practice to make it look good.
You need to practice, and this looks like it was practice, doesn't it? Then what were you going to say? That's right. So let me ask you something. I want to hear from you guys. What are you really good at right now?
Yes.
Well, one at a time. Go on, Katie. You're good at math? That's what I'm talking about. Go ahead.
I'm good at doing two cartwheels at a time.
Two cartwheels at a time?
What?
That's amazing. What about you, Alice? What are you good at?
I'm good at singing.
You're good at singing? That's awesome. What about you, Bibby? What are you good at?
Piano.
You're good at piano. You are good at piano. What about you?
I'm good at video games.
You're good at video games?
No, he's good at Legos the most.
You're good at Legos?
Yeah.
That's awesome. Now, do you just get good automatically?
No.
It takes practice, right?
I'm good at a lot of things that are school things.
That's awesome. Good for you.
I'm good about dancing.
You're good at dancing?
That was awesome.
I was literally showing someone. I'm going to do that later, too. No, listen. I'm losing control. Listen. All right. So, you know, faith is the same thing, right?
Yeah.
And
compassion.
Huh?
Compassion,
right? Can you practice compassion?
No.
You can practice compassion.
Compassion
is being kind to somebody.
Oh.
Can you practice being kind to somebody?
Yeah.
That's right. Is it sometimes hard to be compassionate?
No.
Sometimes it is, right? Especially if we're angry or we're mad, right? But if we practice it, we become better at it, don't we?
Yeah.
Right? Is it sometimes hard to love other people?
Yeah.
Come on, let's be honest. Sometimes it is, isn't it?
Yeah.
For some of y'all, it's not that awesome. But for me, it But sometimes you got to keep practicing and you get better and better at it, right? Here's my hope for you. And this is my hope for the church too. That when we practice compassion, when we practice being nice, when we practice being kind, and we do it over and over again, it becomes more.
Money.
We become more and more, I lost my train of thought.
Good at it.
We become better at it, right?
Yeah.
So let's find ways to keep practicing what we're called to be, right?
Yeah.
Can you do that for me?
Yeah.
All right, let's pray to God. Repeat after me. Dear Lord.
Dear Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For your example.
For your example.
And may you practice.
May you practice.
More kindness.
More kindness.
More compassion.
More compassion.
To have more joy.
Amen.
That's when we get the kitty. That's when we get the kitty.
Never mind.
Never mind.
Nope. I do not want to be one.
What are these?
Something.
Okay. I'm going to meet up with you, Mom.
Go.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that it came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name you have given me, so they may be one, as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the word in the world, so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is the truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they may also be sanctified in the truth. You have heard the ancient story.
Thanks be to God.
In this passage, Jesus knew he was leaving, but Jesus had this tendency where he was never going to give you up or let you down or never turn around and desert you, which is a song by Rick Astley. Here's the problem with my sermon titles, by the way. So I picked the sermon titles by Wednesday, because usually that's when my sermons are kind of finished. By Thursday, I changed my sermon, but I can't change the sign. Therefore, this sermon title has nothing to do with my sermon. So if you notice, I just try to sort of wedge something in there, and I apparently failed miserably. And that's all right. But here's the reality of this passage. Isn't it hard to know what was actually being said? It was a little rough, wasn't it? I mean, it was rough because of how it was worded. And the Gospel of John has a tendency to word things that are sort of hard to follow. You ever do that with songs? Get the words wrong? Well, there's a song called Boys of Summer, and it was done by Don Henley in 1984. And then the Ataris did another version in 2003, an excellent version, by the way. And so one time the Atari version came on the radio, and Jennifer and I started singing that song together. And when it came to the chorus, Jennifer sung Boys of Summer. Now, this is one of my all-time favorite songs. I thought the chorus was Poison Summer. And I sung that for years. And Jennifer just looked at me like, and she's like, it's Boys of Summer, not Poison Summer. I go, no, it's not. It's Poison Summer. It's one of my favorite songs. You can't tell me otherwise. I was wrong. John kind of works the same way, doesn't it? Because it gets really wordy, so it's hard to understand the meaning. So we're going to simplify it. Jesus, and again, it goes back to John chapter 1. As I mentioned over and over again with every passage we study in the Gospel of John, everything goes back to John chapter 1. Jesus is the Word made flesh, the living Logos, the Word that existed before creation. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. And the Word are those universal truths that define God and that define the best parts of ourselves. Truths like justice for all, and compassion towards all, and love to all. The Word. The Word through Jesus is praying for the disciples. And this passage is in the middle of what I call a Nina prayer. Nina is what we call my grandmother because she didn't want to be called grandma. Sometimes I would joke and call her grandma, and that was wrong. She was a strong and an amazing woman who was outspoken and forthright, but she was also very, very strict and had high expectations. But she would do this prayer when I would come and visit her. And it would be like this. Lord, I wish someone would do the dishes and then look at me. And it was odd because the Spirit moved me. And the dishes got done by me. Lord, I wish Eddie would clean his room. And I will miraculously realize that my bed wasn't made. And I would make my bed. You ever hear prayers like that? This passage is a Nina prayer. It's a prayer that gives clear direction. And the key phrase in this passage is Jesus saying, "But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have joy complete in themselves." This prayer is about our having joy in our lives, and this prayer is answering the age-old question, how do we find joy? How will the disciples find joy without Jesus through the injustices they endured as the Roman Empire continued to intimidate people with their army and utilize a system that made the people extremely vulnerable to hunger and to disease and to violence and to poverty? And how do the disciples find joy when they had to go through the corruption they witnessed as some of the religious elite exploited on the people, preying on their hopes and sometimes their guilt? They had to do whatever they had to do for their own financial and social gains. Friends, how do we find joy? How do we find joy when so many lack compassion, refusing to help those in need or care for the struggling? Did you see the people hoarding gas last week? Now, some of it is out of fear. Some of it was out of necessity. I saw a guy have a big old truck with a big old trailer, but he was a landscaper, right? Some of it's out of necessity. Some of it was out of greed, and I'm going to get mine. Lack of compassion. How do we find joy? How do we find joy when so many ignore the injustices around us and we hear things like, "Well, it's not my problem because it doesn't affect me." Or worse, deny that injustices exist because they are experiencing them. How do we find joy when so many reject love, the call of love, overreacting with rage because of simple disagreements? Simple disagreements instead of finding ways of reconciliation. How do we find joy? But in this prayer, Jesus gives us a way to find joy. And one is to have a sense of resolve. Jesus says this, protect them in your name that you have given to me, and protection from the evil one. Did you hear that when it was read? We're not talking about protection from harm per se. Because with life comes pain and scars for both the faithful and the faithless. With life comes struggle and tragedy for both the devout and the atheist. And protection from the evil one is not protection from the devil or some actual being playing the role of villain. John's gospel is more cosmic than that. Jesus' prayer for protection are against those things that deprive us of our humanity and our calling. He's saying, protect us, O Lord, or rather, protect them, O Lord, from greed and selfishness, because greed and selfishness can separate us from the joy of compassion as we hold on to those things we don't need as other people go without. Protect them, O Lord, from fear and panic, because fear and panic can keep us from the joy of justice, because by being afraid to speak out, others suffer because of our silence. Protect them, O Lord, from hate and rage, because hate and rage can keep us from the joy of love by not seeing all people, no matter who they are, as valued and worthy of respect. When we do that, we fail to become who we are called to be. Therefore, we can never be complacent. But instead, we strive for unity and seek sanctity. Let me tell you what that means. Jesus prays so that they, us, so that they may be one as we are one. Jesus is praying for unity because compassion is hard to do when you're doing it by yourself, isn't it? You'll be overwhelmed by those in need. But together, all things are possible. We had a really good week here at church. We really did. Because the Spartanburg 1 school district donated a ton of food to our food pantry. And I mean like literally a ton of food to our food pantry. There are dozens and dozens of boxes in our gym right now that the youth and I are going to get together and work through. Thank you. I'm going to help. You know, they donate dozens of boxes to us and dozens of others to other food pantries in the county to feed the hungry. Now look. Our schools do not have the resources to help elderly families or to help families with young children and infants and toddlers. But we do. We don't have the resources to get so much food at one time. But the schools do. Not one person, not one church, not one school district can work alone. But if we can work side by side, we become the hands and feet of God. Justice is nearly impossible to do by yourself. Because your voice will be drowned out by naysayers and complainers. You ever hear naysayers and complainers? Lord, help us all. You can't do that. One person can't change the world. Even Jesus emboldened and empowered his followers to help him. But we can work side by side. We can bring heaven to work to the least of these. Love is always communal, which means church isn't a place to just to learn about God. And the truth is, you really can do that on your own, at your own time and at your own pace, can't you? All right, you can read your own books. You can watch your own YouTube videos. You can even watch our old YouTube videos, pause it when you get bored and hit play again. Have you ever done that before? Don't nod yes. Church is where love happens. At the feet of God. He was saying, stay focused on the universal truth of justice and speak up and speak out against inequality and be part of a group that gives the voice to the marginalized. He was saying, stay focused on the universal truth of love and welcome all people, seeing the mosaic of the world as beautiful and wonderfully made. And watch your world become bigger because your circle of friends is more diverse. Sanctification. Holiness is not about being pious and not drinking and not dancing and not playing cards, though there's nothing wrong with being pious. You be you. It's not a judgment if that's who you are. But sanctification is about focusing on loving God and loving your neighbor through compassion and justice and kindness. Church, do you hear me? So Jesus prays, but now I'm coming to you and I speak these things in the world so that they may have joy complete in themselves. This prayer is about our having joy in our lives. So let me ask you, do you want to have joy in your life? Say yes.
Yes.
Really, that didn't sound very joyous, did it? And I kind of jumped that at you. I'm not having you look at your neighbor right now. You're welcome. But come next week. Let me ask again. Do you want joy in your life? Say yes.
Yes.
Then don't be complacent. Be resolute and protect yourself from greed and from fear and from hate. Then let's work together and show compassion to our communities by being the hands and feet of God and seek justice for the marginalized by being the loving voice of truth. And choose love, always choose love for all of us by welcoming one another with kindness and grace and peace. Then let's live a life. Then let's live a life, a sanctified and holy life, focusing on those things that matter most and bring heaven to earth for all people. Brothers and sisters, let's have some joy in our lives by living out the call that Jesus, the Word made flesh, exemplified. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Brothers and sisters, please stand and join me in the statement of faith found in your bulletin. Please read with me. We believe in God,
who has created and is creating, who works in others and us through the Spirit. We follow in the way of Jesus, celebrating God's presence, living with respect in creation, loving and serving others, seeking justice and resisting injustice, and seeking out hope and peace. We believe every person, regardless of color, religion, creed, age, class, or orientation, is a child of God. We are connected because we are family. We gather because we all have something to share. We encourage one another and hold each other accountable. But most of all, we love one another. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I want to love the Lord and all the Lord.
for those of you who watch online, we got disconnected in the middle of my sermon, but that part was the most important part where I gave the meaning to life, and I'm sorry you missed it. That's not what really happened. Brothers and sisters, have you been blessed this morning?
Yes.
Hear now this benediction. You are the hands and feet of God. Stay focused. Show compassion. Seek justice. And always choose love. Until next week, amen?
Amen.
Amen.